Hello and welcome to another episode of GDL-IL, GDL Israel. Today we're going to speak about BigQuery and UpScript and how you could leverage those two amazing powerful technologies in order to get some clever insights on your own big data. Now, I didn't prepare any slides today because I thought code will be much more a proper tool for a crowd of developers. So without further ado, let me share my screen with you and show you what we are going to do today. So first of all, we're jumping right into the things, but maybe we'll take a step back and we'll open another tab here just to show you what we are talking about. And when we're talking about BigQuery, the best source to start and try to understand what we have under our hands is the ability to gain insights from your big data. And when we're saying big data, we're speaking about gigabytes or terabytes or petabytes of data. And anyone that works in, let's say, a startup, mid-sized company, or a big organization knows that there's lots of logs, lots of data that is sitting somewhere, and there are true gems in this data. And basically, it's quite hard in most of the cases to ask the right questions and to get a response in a time that will make sense. Luckily, Google BigQuery is a technology that lets you do exactly that and analyze your massive data sets. And the nice things about it is that you have this browser tool that I'll show in a minute and a command line tool that let you play quite quickly with the data even before you start approaching the API and start building your project that will create some useful tool for your organization. Luckily for us, you could go today, and I'll make it a bit bigger, and the sign up is just right here, and it's open now for everyone, so you don't need to have any invite or any beta list. In our little case, you few of the we have today in the past webinar, we dive into something that Ilya Greenberg, and that's importing the HTTP arch query. Let me let you to ask some info on the web, how we could get insights about what's going on with web data. So when we're coming to this browser tool, you could see quite quickly that we have the ability to go and to have those public samples. I'll make it a bit bigger, it'll be easier to read. And in our case, I'll just choose Wikipedia, but you have lots of other things. And first thing, we're getting the schema. If we'll go to the details, immediately you could have first just a grasp of what is the size of this data, and where it was created, when it was created, how many rows we are talking here. In our case, north of 300 million rows. And how this table is composed, so all the different characteristics that you could later on query on. Here, I prepared, and we have here a query history, a simple query that if I'll click on it, let's make it a bit prettier and make it larger. So this query is getting the top 10 sites, 10 articles that were revised frequently. And we want to see just what are those articles that people have changed them again and again and again. When we're running, you see here we're getting how many seconds it's taking. And here in our case, to go and to count over north of 300 million rows took 2.4 seconds. So quite impressive. And here if I'll just take this line and yes, make it bigger, you could see a few of the popular terms. Quite funnily that the list of world wrestling is very, very high, considerably. What we want to show today, and that's something pretty cool, is that the HTTP archive is basically a site that just gather what is going on the web. As we know, it's important to see how things are progress, how things are moving, what are the trends, if it's going forward or backwards. We want to make sure that we know and we have a way to analyze it. And this great initiative is an open source project that I was lucky enough to contribute to it in the past. And all the data here is, of course, downloadable, so you could take it with you and analyze it on your own free time. The only main problem is that it's more than 400 gigabytes of data, so like a magnitude of 10 times of what we saw just a minute ago with Wikipedia. There are a few interesting trends and slides and stats that you could see here on the site itself, but of course it's much more powerful to analyze and to have the ability to query it on our own. So if we go into the browser tool, we have here, and you'll need to edit, and I'll have a post that give you all the little details how you could edit to your project later on. But you have here basically all the runs and all the data that you will want to query later. And again, in our case, I prepared a short query that it's a bit longer, as you can see here, but let's make it a bit more readable. Basically, I'm querying on June and July, but for our example, let's keep it just for June and run it. And what I want to see in this query is which are the most popular sites, basically APIs, that are being used by other sites. So in this case, you can see quite quickly, let's make it a bit bigger. And now let's see it quite well, that Facebook is on the lead, and then you have Google and Dub & Click and Google Syndication and Google Analytics are leading the chart. Of course, you could save this table, you could download it and work with it off of the browser tool on another tools, and it's quite nice way just to see what we're doing and how we are going to approach the data. Now, the big nice thing about it is that with UpScript, and this is the example that I prepared, we could take the same thing that we saw just now, but automated it, and automated it quite quickly and easily. And how we are going to do it, I'll just show the code right here. Maybe we'll just jump and see what are the results look like. So I composed this data from the code that we have, and as you can see here, I have here a new menu item that allow me to run those queries and get the data here. And after I'm getting the data, for instance, in our case, I just wanted to see which are the top 10 sites that are being used by others, but I wanted to run it on the previous 12 months. So I wanted to see some sort of a trend. Is the usage is going to a certain direction? Does it move up? Does it move down? And here I just used the charting to take a few bold examples like Twitter, Google Analytics, and Facebook. And as you can see here, it took just a bit of time, but you could see quite nicely that maybe here at the beginning of 2012, the HTTP archive wasn't crawling the same amount of sites that it's crawling today, so we see quite nice of a ramp up, but you could definitely say something about the end of last year, so around November, December 2012, and then up to today, we see that in February we had a bit of a drop down, and then now you could see the trend. Another interesting aspect is Google Analytics, of course. You could see it very steadily going up, and now it's a bit of flat. And Facebook, and here it's mostly Facebook CDN. It's quite different because I just moved the bar here. Why? I think because of the way the data was sorted. But you could see clearly that it's going up. Then it had some drop at the beginning of this year, and now the trend is quite flat. So it's quite nice and interesting to see trends that are going. Let's jump into the code and just go over it. So the first function here is quite a basic initializing function that will trigger when we'll open the Google sheet that we have right here, and it will just add the menu item that we saw right here. So this is the menu item, as you can see here. Now, I hope that you could still, yeah, okay, you could still see it. So we have this menu item, and let's jump into the code. So this code just added this menu item and letting us do all the different, to run basically all the different queries that we want to run. And here I have another query that just allow me to run all the queries that I have under my hand. So very useful way to just, if, let's say you have a daily dashboard that you want to get insights and to run your several queries and get then get the results back, it will be quite nice to have a function that just gather all the queries and making sure that you are generating them with one entry point. And here in our case, it's the query or the function that will give us the results of which are the top 10 sites or APIs actually that are being used by third parties over time. You could see here that I'm getting a default of where I want this data to be output on the sheet itself. So what is the starting row and the starting column? Then I have this unique identifier to my project. And if you want to mimic it, you'll need to go to the console on Google APIs and make sure that you're creating a new project and you're allowing yourself to run BigQuery. I'll have, again, all the details how to do it in the blog post that I'll publish just after this GDL session. Then we get a handler on the active sheet that we have. In our case, it's this guy, third parties. And here we just dump all the raw data. Here I have all the dates that I want to basically query against. And now the fun part is here where I'm just building the SQL and making sure that this SQL composed from several SQLs, that each and every one of them is just going on the certain file and fetching the information from this specific file. If you saw before that, we're gathering the files in per month. So pages and requests will be gathered on a monthly basis. And then when we query them, it's a much more efficient way to go month by month and get the results back. So after we compose this nice SQL variable, we'll create another query results object. And in this try-catch block, we'll just go to BigQuery object, jobs, and set the query with the project identifier and our SQL. The beauty here is that this object now will run the job in the background, and once it's completed, it will return us get job complete true. What we want to do here is just run on this loop and making sure that we are fetching the results just when this guy is true. And if it's, of course, not, we'll just keep trying. Now we're just setting some boilerplate metadata on the query itself, how many rows we got back, etc. We could definitely dump them into another sheet and get some insights of what were the metadata of the query itself. And last but not least, we're just building the object of dumping the results values. We'll get all the content that we want to put on our sheet, and then we're just getting the right range and then setting the values with results values. Last but not least, we'll just jump here and with the message box inform the user that everything is done. Let's see how it's run. It might take a bit of time, but we'll run it. I'm just choosing the function that I want to run here. In our case, it's this function. And then I'm clicking run. As you can see, it's now running it. And if we'll come here, basically, we're getting a notification that something is working. And now you could see that all is done. We have all the answers. And you see here, we have fresh data that just was produced from this specific function. The code will be, of course, live. Actually, part of this code is already live on my GitHub repository, and it's public. So, of course, I'll have a link here. But you could check out Greenido on GitHub and get different queries here and, of course, all the boilerplate code that I just showed a second ago. Case use for this type of things is the ability to create your own dashboard quite quickly. And if you think about it, when you have this big data inside BigQuery, you could quite quickly go with UpScript and create your daily dashboard, get a trigger, and here is a nice ability to just here, you could put what's your triggers, make sure that, for instance, we want to add a new trigger that will run this specific query on a specific event. And this powerful thing will let us the ability to basically create new dashboards that once we are fetching the data from the query, we can email it, we could update the sheet, and of course share it with our coworkers. So that's what I had this time. And if someone would like to ask questions on the chat or live here, please feel free. So I see one thing from a developer that asking if they could run BigQuery with other languages and technologies, and the answer, of course, is yes. We actually have lots of libraries and clients that are supporting almost, I think, any popular language that is out there. The great way to start and check how you could write with it and how you could work with Java, Python, and others will be to go to this page and just check on BigQuery's APIs. And here you could BigQuery client libraries. And from here, you could see quite quickly that we have lots of client libraries for almost any popular technology that is out there. So if there's other questions, this is the time. If not, thank you for joining us, and we'll be here next week with interesting startups. So be strong, and bye-bye.